So I wanted to preach this morning on hearing God's voice, because it's like people think pastors and dominees and stuff, sometimes people think that we have like maybe a special connection, so we hear a different version of God than you, and then in the week we hear something from God, and then we come talk to you like we're going to give you something from the Lord. And we're also just human, so let me just start off there. We're also just human, and we make mistakes, just as normal humans do. So I want to speak this morning on hearing God's voice and how difficult it is to hear God's voice in today's society. Dis vrek moeilik om die Here te hoor. It's so difficult to hear what God wants to tell you in these times today. What does He want to tell you? I think we have this picture of how it works. We have this picture where I pray, God speaks to me, and then you see that little maniki saying, I now have the word of God, and now I'm being sent into the world. So when I was at university, there was a space in my life where I was really close to God. Ek was naby die Here. I did a lot of things right. I lived a supremely moral life, and I believed everything, and I believed everything when life was on track. I even looked good. I felt good. I was op 'n goeie plek. And so we went on this outreach, and on this outreach we had some person from the street there, and we handing out soup, and I just want to say I want to pray for this guy, and I take this guy's hand, and then a little soft dove hand touches my other hand, and I started praying. I don't look, I just pray, and I'm in a good spiritual place. And when I opened my eyes, it was like an angel sitting there. So now I have this guy from the street that we're trying to help, and I have this angel here. And I thought, this is the story I'm going to tell at my wedding, because this is how I met my bride. And I thought, God sent me this woman because I was in such a good spiritual place that it now has to be. The next step has to be, this has to be my vrou wat ek moet trou. Ek bedoel, hierdie is next level. So imagine you can tell at your wedding, you can tell, I met my bride while praying. That was our first words together, was praying. Needless to say, it never worked out. She messed around a lot. She broke my heart a lot. But many times, it is this idea. Maybe I should be louder. Can you hear me, Terry? Is it still good? We have this idea that I go and I talk to God, and God talks to me, and then I can go, and God sends me into this world. But you know what happens? You come to a place where this happens. So I pray more, and I become more, because I think God talks more. And I become bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, because I am in a spiritual place and I'm in a spiritual high. Now, in life and in spirituality, you get highs and you get lows. Net soos in die lewe. You get spiritual high places and you get spiritual lows. And the danger of these things is you can become spiritually high. Yes, ek lewe nou naby die Here. Ek maak nie nou baie foute nie. My life is sorted. So I'm in the perfect place for God to speak to me now and send me now and use me now. And many times in those places, I fell rock hard. There was another time where I prayed and I said, Lord, make me a man of God. I don't know what that is. Help me understand that. And right after that, it was like the worst time of my life. Well, that I thought was the worst time of my life. But I was in a spiritual high and good place. So let's first say to each other, if you want to hear God's voice, it's not always dependent on you and what you do. You don't have to be in a certain place to hear God's voice. You hoef nie op 'n spiritual high te wees om God te ontmoet nie. You don't have to be on a spiritual high to meet God. You just have to be willing to meet Him. You just have to be willing to go up the mountain, willing to go and pray. It's not about being and living right and correct and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, doing all these things right and ek het niks fout in nie, en ek probeer so min, I try to have as less or nothing sin in my life, and then God speaks to me. No, God is looking for your heart. And remember, that's the message of the New Testament. The Pharisees, the scribes tell people, it's about how you live, it's about your sinlessness, it's about your cleanness, your pureness, it's about all the... No, and then Jesus comes and he says, it's about your dirtiness, but your willingness to say, I want to improve. I want to improve. There's a famous passage in the Bible where the Lord speaks directly to someone. And he says to Samuel, meanwhile, the boy Samuel served the Lord by assisting Eli. Eli was a priest. Now, in those days, messages from the Lord were very rare. I don't think it has changed. And visions were quite uncommon. One night, Eli, who was almost blind by now, had gone to bed. The lamp of God had not yet gone out. Do you hear the atmosphere? Eli is blind, physically, but spiritually as well. He's blind, and it's at night, but the light of the Lord remains. It's a powerful text. The lamp of God has not gone out. And Samuel was sleeping in the tabernacle near the ark of God. So Samuel is not praying, he's sleeping. Suddenly the Lord called out, Samuel. Yes, Samuel replied, what is it? He got up to Eli and he said, here am I. Did you call me? I didn't call you, Eli replied. Go back to bed. And so he did. Then the Lord cried out again, Samuel. And again Samuel got up and he went to Eli. He said, here I am. Did you call me? I didn't call you, my son, said Eli. Go back to bed. Put the same text twice in. On the third time when the Lord called Eli, Eli answered and he realized it was the Lord, and he said, Lord, here is your servant. I'm willing to listen. Gaan lees dit in 1 Samuel 3. I say the answer when God called him and he realized it's God calling me, his answer was, here is your servant. Here is your servant. So, I don't have to be spiritually high or low to meet God. I just have to be willing to meet him. This brings me to the second point, that if you are willing, if you are praying and asking for God to speak, you must be willing to hear what he has to say. So if you are going down and saying, okay, Lord, I don't have it all together, but I want to hear your voice. I want to hear your voice. You must be now willing to hear what you have to say. You know, this is sometimes the biggest challenges in marriages or in marriage counseling, I've seen in marriage counseling, where people do marriage counseling, is when someone has to tell someone the truth. You have to be willing to hear what he or she is now going to say about the other person. This scary, scary stuff. Because you have to be open and you have to be ready for shots now. It's like your CEO or your boss calling you in and you say, okay, your performance review, do you want to hear it? I don't know if I want to hear it, but okay, tell me. So, if I want to hear God's voice, I must remember that I have to be willing to hear what he says. Now, in Samuel, the Lord tells Samuel, I'm going to do very bad things. He doesn't send Samuel and say, Samuel, your new Mercedes-Benz A-Class is waiting outside. He tells Samuel, go and tell Eli, your religious father, go and tell him he's doing wrong. That's what's happening. And we have many instances of this. We have many. I got a few for you. Moses talks to God. In Exodus, he talks to God. Moses, growing up in the palace, hear God's voice in a bush, flames. And what's interesting about that text is, Exodus 3, is the bush doesn't burn out and it intrigues him. So he takes off his shoes and he goes. Now Moses is not in a good spiritual place, né? Moses is in the wilderness because he killed someone. He's not in a spiritual high place. He killed someone. But he was willing to go closer to the bush to meet God. And then God talks to him. And what does God tell him? Moses, go back to the place where you killed someone. I don't want to hear that message necessarily. In Isaiah, the prophet has a vision of God and hears a call. Whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And Isaiah responds, here I am, send me, accepting his role as a prophet. Jonah met Jonah, God sends Jonah to the city Nineveh to call its people to repentance. Jonah never wanted to go there. Jonah initially flees. He tries to flee, but eventually obeys after being swallowed by the fish or the whale. If you want to hear God's voice, you must be willing to hear what he wants to say. I wrote, there's a few more examples. Gideon, and in Judges and Richters, God calls Gideon to deliver Israel from the Midianites. Gideon is unsure, and he seeks sign from God to confirm his calling. He does it again and again because he's unsure. He's not sure, how do I do, what do I do? Because it's about willingness and willingness to hear what God says. In 1 Samuel 3, I just did that example. Mary was a teenage girl. She was a teenage girl who was supposed to go and tell the world, I'm pregnant, without being married. Now, in those days, it was a very big sin because it was a public sphere, and in this public place, you can't go and say, I'm pregnant, because they would also see it, and it would be, So Mary has to tell the world that the Lord has made me pregnant, and my husband, and we're not even married yet. And then one of the biggest ones was Paul, Saulus. Interestingly, when Paul is sent, he's met with someone who says, yes, Here, have you heard about Paul? Like, this guy's rough. Are you sure you wanted me to meet him? I forgot his name now, but go read in Acts. When he goes to meet Paul, he prays to the Lord and he says, are you sure it's Saul I must go and meet? Because I have heard of him, and I've heard that Saul, he's quite a character. He's like a MMA fighter guy. It's kind of scary. And so he sends him. The problem is this. I don't think we realize how instant gratification works in our lives. We forgot it. We've forgotten it. Sis, toe julle groot word, in die goeie ou dae, in the good old days, you had to wait for Christmas to get a present. You had to wait for your birthday to get a present. You had a little spaarvarkie. Nee, wie het 'n spaarvarkie gehad? Where you had to put in your money to get something. You had to, the only people who really saw you in a bikini or without a shirt was in December. In December they saw you without it. So you could have walked the whole year. You could have eaten chicken breast without the sonder die velletjie, nee, Jakkie sonder die velletjie, weet jy die hoender. En laat jy ripped is en dat jy goed lyk, want is eers December. Now the world is so much, it's so bad that I see the sun is like, it's almost changed. Winter has just begun to change, and then the bikini photo starts popping up. And then the world has changed. It is now so much, if you're unsure about yourself, you can get gratification immediately. If I don't feel good today about myself, you know what I do? I go on my phone, I look for a good photo somewhere, where someone took a good photo, where I stood like this, and they must turn sideways because you look thinner. I don't know how it works. And as soon as you do that, you get that photo, you post it, and what do you get? You get your likes, and you get your stuff. You get your gratification. And, okay, let's say you're a bit older, you're not worried about looks and those things anymore. I want my food, I want it now. It's raining, I'm not going to go to Checkers is going to come to me. I'm not going to go to Woolworths is going to come to me. And you know what? My wife is mad at me, so Woolworths can bring me flowers. Have you seen that? Woolworths dash it, nou sê ding waar jy die blomme kan insit. What is it? Blossoms, wat hulle agterop sit. The world has become like this. It's become so saturated with, we don't need patience. You don't need patience for anything. You can sort out everything right now at this very moment. And I see that in my children. I see how my children, it's like that. It just goes like that. What do you need? Got it. What do you need? Got it. What do you need? What do you want for your birthday? That. Okay, get on Takealot, go on Takealot, search the item, buy the item. It'll be delivered Monday at your door. I don't even need to go and leave my house to find the ideal gift for my kid. You cannot say this doesn't affect you. And now in this world where you can immediately get acknowledgement, acceptance, or the opposite. In this world, you want to hear God's voice immediately. You want to go and pray and say, Here, I can net op take a lot bestel in Woolworths. Now is it Ebert? Now met even my prod. And I think we must be very careful with that. Because again, when God speaks, He doesn't inflate the individual. He doesn't talk to Samuel and then Samuel becomes this big figure. And then it's all about Samuel, and it's all about Gideon, and it's all about David, and it's all about... He talks to that small figures, and He sends them into difficult stuff. And you know who gets the reward at the end? God. Hearing God's voice is about God. It's about His voice, not mine. So hearing God's voice is about His voice, not mine. Remember this. When God spoke, and when he made a promise and a purpose and everything, He said, it's about the world. It's not about you and me. For this is how God loved the world. It doesn't say that God loved you so much. He just wants to speak with you. He just wants to talk with you. You just have to be spiritually good. He said, no. For God so loved the world. It's not all about me. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. Now this world, interesting in the Greek, this world is cosmos. It's the entire creation, and it includes those people and the things that do not believe in God. So God loved everything so much, His creation so much, that He sent His only Son. So if you pray, if you want to hear God's voice, you don't need to be in a good place, you have to be willing. If you are willing, you have to be willing to hear what He has to say. And you know what He says a lot of the times, or most of the times? He says, go into the world. I am sending you into the world. I'm sending you back to the most horrible place you want to be. You don't want to be there? I'm sending you back there. You don't want to go there? I'm sending you back there. How many times did God send someone to where he or she wants to be? Waar lees julle dit? Het julle dit al gelees? Here, ek wil graag asseblief soheen toe gaan. And even if they wanted to go there, they couldn't. They wanted to go to the promised land. It took them 40 years because they didn't have GPS. But hearing God's voice is not about you hearing God's voice. What does God want to say to your family, to your husband, to your work, to your church, to those around you? When God speaks, it's about His people. He doesn't speak about you and you, what you want. It's about His people. So God so loves the world. This is something I read that was interesting. A lot of people come to you and they say, I've heard the Lord say, or ek hoor die Here sê, of die Here het vir my gesê. It's difficult words to say. And some people use it, and you can use it. But how do you argue against it? How do you say that, I don't think the Lord told you that? Now, I see a lot of things on social media, and I see a lot of churches where it is ridiculous. They have races in church running, and then people start falling over, and then the pastor just walks past. They have places where they jump on the roof, and they say it's all about Jesus and it's all about these things, but it's all about me. There's a fine line between it's all about me and it's all about God. Because when it's about God, it's not about me, it's about God. So if someone comes to you and he says, the Lord told me, die Here het vir my gesê. If you are busy with God, someone will not surprise you with something else that God says or wants. I come in with the God doesn't just, if you're busy Bible study, church, etc., you're busy on the spiritual journey. Someone doesn't come and surprise you with something completely different. He just awakens something that God has already stirred in your heart. Daar's klaar iets in jou hart. Die Here is klaar besig om met jou te praat. You think the Lord is telling you this. He's already busy with you. So someone will come and confirm it. Be very careful of this. I've seen false prophets and I've seen what people can say. And I've seen how they can manipulate by using words like "Die Here het vir my gesê," and "The Lord told me." Listening to God's voice sometimes requires us to speak His language and study His character. So, in die gereformeerde tradisie sê ons, if you know it's God speaking to you, you are allowed to test it. And you test it with what? With fellow Christians, fellow believers. Jy toets dit met fellow gelowiges. And you toets dit, you test it to His word. So if I feel the Lord is telling me I have to leave my wife and I have to marry some girl in Australia today, and I tell that to the congregation, what are you going to say? Is Willem go and do it? No. Because I don't have the Spirit, we have the Spirit. So as we are communicating, as we are having church, the Spirit is working. And the Spirit uses, and God uses His church. And if the pastor says, oh, I want to go and I want to leave my wife and marry someone in Australia, the church can tell me, hey, pastor, do me luister. The Spirit doesn't work. It doesn't work like that. It's not in the Bible. What do you read in the Bible? What do you get from the Bible? How can you test that God is working and talking to you? There's a few things that God says that you can always test to and it will always stay the same. His covenant. Say belofte. He said, I am holding on to you and I will never, ever, ever let you go. I'm giving you the sign of the rainbow and it'll never stop. So every time you doubt it and you want to test and you say, Die Here het van my vergeet, and someone tells you, the Lord hasn't forgotten about you, you can read in Scripture, the Lord has not forgotten about you. Now, interesting, if you read the Bible, how many quick fixes were there? How many times do I read in the Bible that someone waited 40 days, 40 years, 70 years? Jeremiah waited, they waited 70 years. You know Jeremiah 29 verse 11. Ek weet wat ek vir jou beplan. I know what I plan, my plans are for you. Nee, goeie goed. Ek weet wat ek vir jou beplan. Voorspoed. Goeie dinge. And then, Jeremiah 29 verse 11. I know what my plans are for you. Good. And then when does the situation change? Just read verse 12. It changes 70 years after that. Kan ek gou sien wie 70 jaar oud? Wie's ouer as 70? Het jy al 70 jaar gewag vir dat jy have waited 70 years for a promise? That's a long time. That's a long time. So God's covenant is everlasting. He's not worried about time. He's not worried about fixing it immediately, He has His purpose. Another thing that I heard from another Dumi was very interesting was he was very cross with God because his mother passed away from cancer. And a lot of people, we get cross with God with a lot of things. And he said his mother, while she was dying, she told him, remember, God is innocent. And it was really powerful hearing this because we tend to be very mad at God sometimes because He doesn't, I praat, die Here praat nie met my nie. Die Here het van my vergeet. Die Here het, He's forgotten about me. But remember, this world is the way it is because of people, not because of God. He created the garden. He didn't mess it up. He created humankind. He didn't mess it up. He didn't create a war. We created wars. He doesn't force you to drink and drive. You drink and drive. You roll the car. He doesn't roll the car. You built the car. You drive the car. You roll the car. You get on the bike. You drive the bike. En jy ry almal mos mooi op in die spoedgrens met jou fietse. Nee, ek grap. As jy Harley ry, ry jy binne in die spoedgrens, want hy kan nie oor die, he can't go faster than them. So, remember, God is innocent. So, if you struggle, the world is broken because of people and what people do. And then this last one was powerful, His incarnation. He became flesh. And this is the coolest thing is, God, Philippians 2, God chose to not be God and cling to His godly status. He chose to become flesh, human being. He chose to serve. He chose to be, hy was gehoorsaam aan die Here, tot die dood. I was listening to God, sticking to God. He became flesh. That picture there, he became flesh. You know what that means? That means that God speaks to you and me. He's not somewhere there in the sky from a distance, God is watching us. He speaks to us. He became flesh. He became us. So sometimes if you want to hear God, listen to your neighbor. Listen to your wife. Listen to your husband. Listen to people around you. He speaks us. So if you read the Bible, have you seen in the Bible, like Moses goes to the bush. He's not surprised by the bush not burning out. Or he's surprised about it, but hy skrik homself nie in 'n ander geloof in nie. And many times when you read the Bible, these miraculous things happen. And nowhere I say, well, hier is hierdie oud om dood geskrik nie. The things that happen in the Bible were quite natural to them. It was quite natural to them. To see things happening like that was quite natural. They didn't saw the ten plow and they said, oh, wow, you serious? They saw it and they thought, well, God is working here. So God spoke to the language of the people in the Bible in their language, in their context, in their time, and in their way. And the same way God will speak to you and me today. Yes, he can use whatever. He can use technology. He can speak to you through technology. He can speak to you through whatever. How God answers prayers depends on how we hear God. So I have to be willing to listen. I don't have to be spiritually good or spiritually. This willingness means he can talk to me. If he talks to me, he can tell me anything. Anything. And if he tells me that, I must be willing to hear that. And then I have to be, wat is die Engels vir gehoorsaam? Obedient. Thank you. I have to be obedient. To hear God's voice, I have to be obedient. And then I want to end with this. To hear God's voice, to be willing to listen, to be obedient, to follow God, means that I do not have it all together. I do not come and say, I've heard everything from the Lord, from now it's finished. It is something you exercise. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials. We said it. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials. This is Romans 5. For we know that they help us develop endurance. Last week het ek gepreek oor endurance, uithou vermoë, endurance. And the endurance, endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confidence, or our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappoint, for we know how clearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. And the Afrikaanse vertaling sê, en ons verheug ons in die swaar kry, want ons weet, die swaar kry kweek egtheid van geloof, die egtheid van geloof kweek hoop, en die hoop beskaam nie. Hearing God's voice is exercising to listen. It's being willing, obedient to exercise. It's some aanhou en aanhou en aanhou. Otherwise, I wouldn't have a job. If I did everything correctly the first time, if I listened to God the first time, everything correctly, and all of you listened, all churches should be closed today. It should be done, because we all listened, we all got the message, and we're all going home. But every time, I have to remember, God became flesh, he speaks to me every day new. Dis iets wat ek inoefen. And dan hierdie inoefen is even in bad times, it's about exercising to listen God's voice. Romans 8 tells it as well, he says, you know what, even if you come to a point where you don't know what to pray, you don't know what to say, you don't know what God is telling you, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groaning that cannot be expressed in words. Die Heilige Gees pleit vir ons, and the Father, listen how beautiful this is. Listen properly. And the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us as believers in harmony with God's own will. This is what I thought the Lord told me this week. He's, Willem, if you want to hear my voice, go and exercise to listen. Gaan oefen. En gaan toets dit. Because sometimes you hear him. And sometimes you're spiritually high, like when I met my future wife, only to realize she was not my future wife. But the girl after her was my wife. So maybe this is just, well, a chapter. Faith is endurance, listening. Oefen, 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 oefen. You're not going to get it perfect because you are not perfect. You have to be willing, obedient, to listen, hear what he wants to say. May God bless you with that.